thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.
Good. Everybody's so much more cheerful when the weather's a little bit cooler, I think. I'm Chris Stecker. I'm the horticulture technician and the Master Gardener Program Coordinator for Extension. I see a lot of familiar faces here, but I see a couple of people I've not seen before. So this is our last Think Green Thursday, and today we're going to talk about bulbs that bloom in the spring but you plant in the fall. And I'm going to start off by showing you these, which are bulbs. I don't have any flowers from the bulbs we're going to plant today because they bloom in the spring. But these are dahlias that were grown from bulbs that are planted in the spring. So, and the reason that these are here is because one of our Extension Master Gardeners, Linda Loy, actually these are all prize winners from the State Fair this year. So we had a program on summer bulbs last year, and actually dahlias grow from tuberous roots rather than bulbs, but we're going to talk about that now. So, tuberous roots.
That can be yours rooting for $50.
Yes. So thank you for bringing us some color, because the colors are going to be up here now. All right. Welcome to the flower show. This picture was taken at the Paul Singer Botanical Garden in Kernersville. They always have a spectacular bulb show in the spring, so I suggest you get out there. It's free to go take a look. Why do we grow bulbs? Well, for bright, showy flowers, especially in the early spring, they're easy to grow, relatively inexpensive, and they combine well with other plantings. The term bulb often includes corms, tubers, and rhizomes, and all of these are underground food storage organs that contain large amounts of stored carbohydrates. So that's where the energy is to make the flowers. True bulbs have many leaves compressed in the bulb, and they have a flower primordium. That just means that in the middle here, this is actually the flower. It's right here in the middle, waiting to come up, and it includes onions, believe it or not, tulips, daffodils, and lilies. Corms are swollen stems. It's very difficult sometimes to tell the difference between a true bulb and a corm because they look very similar on the outside. They have a tunic, which is the papery coating on the outside, and they have roots at the bottom, and they have a pointy top, many of them, some of them don't. But if you cut them open, and I did not cut any of these open because while relatively inexpensive, they are not cheap. But they include crocus, cyclamen, and colchicum, among many others. And here's some corms that actually, these corms were planted this fall, but much earlier in the fall because they actually bloom in the fall. These are cyclamen, and also planted colchicum, which if we go out in the garden, you'll see the colchicum's already up, and those were planted in the first part of September. So tubers and tuberous roots, swollen roots, they have one to several eyes near the old stem. Tubers without eyes won't grow. That's why when you plant a potato and you cut a piece to plant, you might have to make sure it has at least one, preferably two eyes when you plant the potato piece. And that includes dahlias, the gorgeous dahlias over there, sweet potatoes, and Irish potatoes. Rhizomes are swollen roots, and they include bearded iris and cannas. So there's some iris. You notice that the iris bulbs, these German iris, they grow practically on the surface of the soil. And when you plant them, you don't cover with a lot of soil. By the way, I don't know if you noticed when you came in, but we've got, this is a immortality, which is an iris that pretty much blooms off and on beginning in April or March even, up until hard freeze. In November, they're often, flowers. If you only have one iris, plant this one. Always available at the plant sale. Okay, when you buy bulbs, look for large bulbs. The large for its variety. Some bulbs will be larger than others. Daffodils will generally have, standard daffodils will generally have large bulbs. Standard tulips will have large bulbs. And the larger the bulb, the more food is available to develop blossoms. Now, some of the smaller plants will have smaller bulbs, but you want the plant to be as big as possible for whatever variety it is. And very small bulbs may not bloom the first year. Bulbs are often graded and sold by circumference, and bigger bulbs cost more. So that's when you see it in the catalog, when you look up in the catalog, it will say 14 to 16 centimeters. That's around the bulb. Avoid root plate damage, which may result in poor root growth. Avoid, this is pretty much common sense, moldy or shriveled bulbs, which may indicate poor quality. Remember, that's all that, bulb should be firm. That's the carbohydrates, that is the new plant that's all stored in there. So if it's shriveled, you're not going to get much action out of it. It could be disease, the bulb should be firm. Avoid any soft, sour smelling or lightweight bulbs, which may indicate a fungal disease, and the bulb will not bloom. Purchase from a reputable source. You can find a wide variety of cultivars in catalogs and online. All the bulbs that I have today came from Brett and Becky's Bulbs in Virginia. That's not to say they grew them. They get most of their bulbs from the Netherlands, and that's where a lot of these bulbs, some are from, very few are grown in the United States. Be wary of sales. Late season sales may mean lower quality bulbs. When you store them, now when they come to you, what you should do is plant them immediately, because they're going to be shipped to you at the proper planting time. If you can't, they can be stored at cool temperatures. Not cold temperatures, but cool temperatures. So 60, 65 degrees for a day or two. And we've had perfect weather for holding these bulbs for the last few days. So these arrived, the bulbs were planted today, arrived last, one day last week. No, this week. Maybe Saturday? I don't remember. Anyway, not too long ago. Sorry, I've been a little confused. But bulbs dug in the summer should be replanted immediately, or now you can dig and dry them until the tunic is papery, and again, that's the papery sheath on the outside, then stored in a ventilated container in the refrigerator until planting time. So that's a little bit different than just holding them until you plant them. Bulbs held over winter and planted in the spring won't flower. I get this call every year, several times a year, around January or February. I got these bulbs last fall. I didn't plant them. Should I plant them? Well, you can, but your chances are they will not bloom. Okay, site selection.
Fall in the spring or ever?
It depends what condition they are when you finally plant them. If they're still firm, they might eventually bloom. But if they're shriveled or dry, because they've spent so much time out of the ground at room temperature or worse. Okay, most bulbs need well-drained soil and require at least 6 hours of full sun each day. And that's for best results. A lot of bulbs can take a little bit of shade, so that's, you just won't get as many flowers. Many soil types are tolerated, but most bulbs prefer soil rich in organic matter. Hardy bulbs are usually planted at a depth of 2 to 3 times their height. Sometimes that's 2 to 3 times their width, but it's about the same one either way. This is a rule of thumb for almost all bulbs. Mix in a slow-release fertilizer high in phosphorus, such as bone meal. When we just prepared some beds to put bulbs in, and I put a little bit of superphosphate because I know our soil is low in phosphorus. A soil test is always a good idea. It will tell you exactly what your soil needs. The bulb booster has any fertilizer that has a high middle number, it is higher in phosphorus. So in other words, bone meal, the analysis I think is 0, 12, 0, something like that. So that's your phosphorus number. I use superphosphate, which is 0, 18, 0. You would just use a little bit less. I probably put on my little patches, which are probably 2 square feet, I probably use a couple tablespoons of triple superphosphate and incorporated it into all the soil. If you plant a little bit at the bottom and mix it in, if you're planting individual bulbs, I would use about a teaspoon just mixed into the bottom of the hole. Mix it into the soil. Phosphorus is a mineral that a lot of locally our soils are lacking in phosphorus or low in phosphorus, which is apparently opposite of some places that are more affected, that more affect the Jordan Lake, because there's a lot of Jordan Lake rolls. A lot of the landscaping companies will not put down phosphorus anymore because of that. It moves slowly through the soil, but it can wash off, which is what affects the algae blooms in the Jordan Lake. Anyway, that's just an aside. So you won't hurt anything if you mix it into the soil. Okay, protect bulbs from wildlife. Tulips are mostly treated as an annual here because tulips are very attractive to all kinds of wildlife. The voles will eat the bulbs, the squirrels will dig them up, the deer will eat the plants. They're delicious. That's all I know. I've never eaten one, but I hear from the squirrels. And what we did, I actually got a recommendation when I ordered the cyclamen and the colchicum from Brent and Buck Becky's, and they said to protect from squirrels. So, because the squirrels, they don't eat them, they just dig them up, because that's what they do, right? That's what squirrels do. Squirrels don't have good memories, they bury nuts, and then they go just dig anywhere it's easy to dig. And if you just planted something, it's easy to dig there because the soil is soft. So I've got a little bit of chicken wire here and some pins, and I just laid that down over where I planted the bulbs and pinned it down, and two bad squirrels.
Then lay it over.
I just laid it down on top of the soil and used these pins to pin it down and to discourage them from digging.
Now when you pick it up?
You don't ever have to pick it up.
Really, the bulbs.
They'll come right through it. And I'll show you some of that when we go out. Bulb maintenance. Fertilize with a complete fertilizer such as 5-10-5 right after the bulb is bloomed. Fall fertilization with phosphorus can be helpful. Again, a soil test is recommended. You do not need, if your soil is fine for phosphorus and potassium, there's no need to add those things. However, nitrogen is leached out of the soil, so you might want to use a fertilizer that has nitrogen, which is the first number, and you can use just a straight blood meal, is a 12-0-0, and you can just top dress with that. It takes a little bit longer to work into the soil, but it's organic and it's pretty easy to use, so you can just put that down. Bulb maintenance. Allow the foliage of spring blooming bulbs to die back on its own. Plants must perform photosynthesis to store food in the bulb and form a flower bud for next year. Once it's yellowed and senescing, you can remove it. That means you gotta wait. I know it's not pretty. Don't braid it because that reduces the amount of sunlight that gets to the leaves. You want it to still have sun getting on it. Probably your best solution is to plant other plants around it to mask the dying foliage. Bulbs such as daffodils, snowdrops, and grape hyacinths multiply and should be divided regularly. Others, such as tulips and hyacinths, only replace the old bulb each year, so they don't make a big mass that gets crowded. Bulbs are best divided and transplanted when they are dormant in late June or July, or you can do it at this time of year if you know where they are. So turn on the light for a second. I'm going to show you something. I actually dug this up yesterday when I was preparing a bed for the bulbs we're going to plant today. And I was very excited about it because the tips were showing of this. This is one of the bulbs we're going to talk about. This is Leucojum. I don't know if you can see that. See the green tips? They were coming out of the soil. It was kind of in my way, but there was only on one side, so I thought, let me dig them, I'll put them on the other side. So when I dug it, you can break it apart. And here's a very nice Leucojum bulb. Has lots of new growth. Actually, I think this is a corm, the way it's growing. Lots of new growth coming out. You can put this in the ground and it will spread. We'll talk about Leucojum in a minute. Somebody's going to have to vacuum. So that you can dig them if you can find them. And again, that's the tricky part because the tops have died down and you've cut them back and now what? Some bulbs, such as this Leucojum, start putting up, and grape hyacinths, start putting up leaves in the fall so you can see where they are and easily do that. Okay. I could just stay here, couldn't I? Maybe I'll do that. Okay, protect your tasty bulbs from wildlife. This works for me anyway. That's 9 whole eggs, 2 ounces of peppermint oil, and that's peppermint oil, not peppermint extract. Mix it in a blender with water to make a quart. Add water to make 3 gallons, and then you spray to wet. Now, my sprayer holds 1.5 gallons, so I make this 1/2 time, and I don't think it's critical whether you use 4 eggs or 5 eggs or 4.5 eggs. So, the egg is just basically a sticker to make it stick to the plant. And it actually does, once it's dry, it's actually relatively rainproof, but remember to spray new growth. So that might save your tulips from the deer. Or you can plant not so tasty bulbs. So here's a nice list of some not so tasty bulbs to wildlife spring blooming bulbs. We've got Allium, Anemone blanda, Bulbocodium vernum, Narcissus, Chandoxa, Scilla siberica, Galanthus, Leucojum, Muscari, and one Crocus thomasinianus, which is the Tommy Crocus. Okay, Narcissus, the most cost-effective, pest-free, long-term perennial bulb. It has 13 divisions, according to their flower shape and heritage. They grow in almost all areas of the U.S. as long as there is discernible winter, from 4-inch miniatures to 2-foot giants. Shades of cream, yellow, and pure white, with cups ranging from white to deep orange and some with a touch of red. Many are fragrant, and bloom times range from early to late spring. So here's just some of the flower forms available in Narcissus. So this, and it's funny, there's 13 divisions. And they all look like this, which is funny. So this is actually a bulb, a main bulb and a daughter bulb. So this is almost twins, they're so big. If you plant a bulb like this, plant the whole thing and it will separate itself. You can break them apart, especially when they're this mature, and they probably will grow two plants. So. And Narcissus geranium. I point this out because I actually have these bulbs, and I have 25 of them to give to you. It's a division 8, which is Tazetta. There are usually 3 to 20 flowers to a stout stem. Leaves are broad, perianth segments spreading. Those are the petals. Not reflex, that means they don't turn back, and the flowers are fragrant. This is a historic 1930 perennial, and you have to make sure you plant it where you'll notice and benefit from its wonderful fragrance until late mid-spring. So I guess after with this session, I'm going to give everybody one of these.
Cool.
And if I run out, then I have a few of the miniatures. Tulips, the most colorful members of the spring blooming bulbs. All colors of the spectrum are represented except true blue, divided into 15 divisions based usually on shape, bloom time, or heritage. The National Garden Bureau has deemed 2018 the year of the tulip. So there you go. We're not planting any tulips. Tulips have been in cultivation for at least 400 years. Holland produces most of the world's annual tulip crop, and they are much tastier to wildlife than narcissus and rather more temperamental. Tulips are often treated as an annual here.
Do deer live in Holland?
I bet they'd move there if they could. So here's just some of the many, many forms of tulips there are. So tulips probably have the most colors. They have the only real red, which is kind of a shame. So you might try that spray, see if that helps. Or plant in and put some, there are some other ways you can plant, and I've tried this, reason I don't have it up here because it didn't work for me, but digging permatil or pea gravel into the soil might discourage voles from eating the bulbs.
Or you can double plant the tulip on top of the daffodil.
That, well, that's true. You can try interplanting with, didn't I have that on there? Oh, maybe that. I thought I had. You can also try interplanting with the bulbs that they don't eat, like the narcissus. Narcissus are poisonous to almost everything, so even the bees don't visit narcissus. So they're kind of, use them like your little fence around your tulips, or try it anyway. Yes.
Could you not put that cage that you showed?
The cage would help against the bulbs. But it won't do anything about the deer.
Yeah.
Alliums. Alliums, again, this is one that's a... these are, now I'm going to start on the ones that are not tasty. Alliums add an architectural form to the garden, range in height from 4 inches to 7 feet, with heads from the size of a quarter to that of a volleyball. Shades of pink and purple to white and a couple of yellows. These are not particularly perennial either. They're at Duke Gardens, they do a beautiful plantings every year of alliums. So if you want to see alliums in bloom, go to Duke Gardens in the early spring. If you plant them in your garden, plan on replanting them in a couple of years. Also, you need to have great drainage for these. Windflower, Anemone blanda. It's an ephemeral ground cover, 3 to 4 inches tall, in shades of purple, pink, and white. It takes full sun to mid-shade, and it blooms March to April. Spring meadow saffron, Volvocodium vernum. Purplish pink crocus or colchicum-like flowers, just 3 to 4 inches tall. Leaves appear with flower, but mature to full height after flowering, and they bloom late winter to early spring. No.
Okay.
Saffron comes from a crocus that blooms in the fall, a real crocus.
Will they come up year after year?
These? Mm-hmm. Yes, they should. They should naturalize very well. If you plant, you could actually plant them in your lawn. Any of these, this is the Bulbocodium, what else do I have here? Some of these other ones that I have here, that as long as they don't grow much taller than your lawn, crocus you can plant in your lawn. I would try the Tommy crocus in the lawn, as long as they don't get much taller than your grass, because you don't want to be mowing them down. Gloria the Snow, Chiandoxa, great understory plant for taller bulbs, grows 3 to 8 inches tall, blooms late winter to early spring, and it's good for naturalizing in rock and woodland gardens. Here's the Crocus thomasinianus. This one is less attractive to squirrels. So if you're getting frustrated by animals eating your crocuses and you love crocuses, definitely try this. Oriental hyacinth. This is, believe it or not, we've got one that's planted out by the front. It's probably been there. Well, it's been there as long as I've been here. and it comes back every year. I don't know who planted it. It's very fragrant. It's just one flower. Again, we talked about how hyacinths don't increase in size, but it comes back every year, very reliable, smells wonderful. So plant it where you can appreciate it.
It's very lonely.
It's lonely, yes. We're planting some more friends for it today. So star flower, Ifion, this one's a real low grower, but so pretty. Sweetly fragrant flowers, pest resistant, great for edges of borders, just 2 to 4 inches tall. And it also comes in white. I guess maybe two. Dutch iris are a bulb rather than the rhizomes. And it's a florist flower. It's another one that just comes up one. So if you want a bunch of them, plant a whole bunch of them. And they do make excellent cut flowers. Leucogium, snowflake. This is the one that we dug up yesterday, and we're going to replant right now. Pure white bells, green tips open. Another long-lived perennial in the garden. Apparently, it does not ever need to be divided, but can easily be divided. And grape hyacinth. This one is definitely will naturalize. It will spread. You'll find it all over your garden. And this is one that starts coming up in the fall, so you can see it if you need to move it.
How many of those would you have to plant to get
old? One. One and be very patient. I think they're planted about 2 inches apart.
Martha just planted 1,000 of them.
Who did?
Martha Stewart's garden.
By Martha, you meant Martha's minions?
Her people.
Well, I'm getting to that point. So in other words, and a lot of times with bulbs, like you will plant, it'll be per square foot. So you would probably plant 15 per square foot, 16 per square foot. So measure your area, multiply times that. So that's a lot of bulbs. Siberian squill, Scylla. This one is one that takes more shade, so we're actually planting some today. The master gardener's already planted them, I think. They take more shade than the others, and it blooms early to mid-spring. Plus, it's blue.
Plus, it's smelly.
Well, the flowers smell good.
Yeah.
Okay, a few tips for using bulbs in the landscape. Small groups of bulbs tucked among perennials, shrubs, or rocks create bright accents. Group several together so they make a strong visual statement. So just, we're going to plant some in the rock garden today, and we'll try and see how they do in the screed garden. Bulbs look great by themselves, but try colorful combinations for a knockout punch. Be conscious of course, if you want to do this, and you do plant the late-blooming tulips with the early-blooming might not get the impact you want. So and if you look at the catalogs, they generally tell you when they're going to bloom, early spring, mid to late spring, whatever, they will tell you. So if you want to do a color combination, you have to make sure that they bloom at the same time. All right. If you want to duplicate the big, bold masses of bulbs in botanical gardens, keep in mind, these gardens use dozens of employees and volunteers, thousands of dollars to plant these masses every year. They plant this every year. These are not an annual thing. So if you have minions and you have money, you too can do this every year. So, it's a bunch of children who can dig. All right, you can plant pansies and other winter hardy early bloomers in the fall to coordinate with your splashes of bulbs come spring. So this is something you can do. This is just a small area. Absolutely, yes. Pansies are definitely great with bulbs, spring bulbs. Mingle bulbs among perennials to help hide the bulb's foliage as it fades. Definitely a good idea. Create a flowering meadow under trees and even in the lawn with some low-growing early bloomers that spread like Siberian squill, grape hyacinths, and crocus thomasinianus. Toss them by the handful and plant them where they land. It looks more natural that way. Create spring bouquets by planting little bulbs, grape hyacinths, over big bulbs, daffodils. Again, if you want them to bloom at the same time, just check their bloom periods. So today we're going to plant, we're going to plant some miniature daffodils and some anemone blanda and some Iphion and some Bulbocodium. Some perennials, such as butterfly weed and perennial hibiscus, are notorious slow to wake up in the spring. To prevent bare spots, mix in some spring blooming bulbs. The bulbs' foliage will begin to fade as the perennials begin to grow. So again, Narcissus geranium, I just brought that up again so I remember to hand them out. And that's it. Any questions? Yeah. All right.
What about containers? Planting bulbs in containers?
You would plant them in the containers just as you would in the ground. So I would plant the bigger bulbs, the jonquils and tulips, in the lowest level, and then as the bulbs get smaller, stack them up.
So I know I've lost some of my stuff that was in containers over a really harsh winter because they just got too cold. Would you do something different, or wouldn't it make any difference to a bulb?
Well, it depends what kind of a container it is. I would use one of the stock rather than use plastic. Use concrete if you've got it, or use one of the styrofoam.
That's thick. And
that's something that's insulated. Thicker gives a little bit more insulation. Mm-hmm. If you have to, you can provide insulation by putting other pots around it, putting bales of straw around it, and you protect the soil from freezing. It has to be really cold for the bulbs to freeze. And if you keep pots out on your patio with plants that come back the next year, you're probably fine with the bulbs. So, yes.
So did you say you need to pick up the bulbs every year?
No. Some like if your daffodils have been blooming great and they're in enough sun and they suddenly stop blooming, they might be overcrowded. And this could take several years before this happens. But they'll give you a sign when they start blooming. But most things actually do pretty well. These Leucogium bloom every year, and they have been in the ground for longer than I've been here, which is since 2002, and never dug up. This is the first time they've been dug up. And you see, it's a nice big clump, but it still blooms fine.
There's a sign there, so if you dig it up, wait until it stage.
If you want to transplant them, wait until after the foliage dies down. Mm-hmm. You can still see the foliage in June or July, so you can dig them up then. Or if you know where they are, you can dig them up at planting time in the fall.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How about gladiolus?
Well, gladiolus is a spring planted bulb. So that would be one that you would plant with your dahlias in the spring.
But if you planted them in the spring, can you leave them in the ground, or will they?
Well, this is what I say about dahlias and gladiolas. If it's a prize winner that you would be devastated if you lost it, I would dig it up in the fall and take it in and put it in sawdust or something just to keep it dry. And a basket. Okay.
Like a kitchen basket. You know, what do you want? Yeah. And do you keep it in the
lawn? Do you keep that in your garage? However, we have a dahlia out in the garden here. It's been here it's probably been here 6 or 7 years at least. It comes back every year. Some gladiolas will come back every year, or maybe they won't. So
the best advice on that is you just over mulch.
Yeah, mulch. Add a whole bunch of mulch in the fall.
6 or 8 inches.
Deep mulch. So do you ever dig yours?
Oh, hell. Much work.
So these have never been dug. And here they are. Look at that. Okay. Yes.
So when you're talking about the clear recipe,
yes.
I just missed the end of that when you said once it's dry, what do you do?
Well, once it's dry, it actually, it's pretty water, rain resistant, but you have to definitely, because they'll put out new growth. When it puts out the new growth, like if you spray it when just the leaves are up, and the when the flower comes up, you definitely need to spray again because there's no spray on that.
Okay, thank you.
What's a good places to get to buy these?
I should have brought a catalog out here. Brent and Becky's Bulbs is where we ordered them, but there's, I mean, I get catalogs from all over the place. I like Brent and Becky's because it's relatively local. It's Virginia, and they send great planting advice information. Yes.
There's an actual, it's just mail order in Asheville called Eden Brothers.
Oh, that's another one.
Eden Brothers is where I get all my bulbs from mine. Yeah, and they send good directions, and all the lilies they've ever sent are huge. So,
okay, so there's many sorts. Sources, yes.
Uh-huh. You said to make a quart of the eggs and the
right.
and then add three more quarts to make it?
No, the quart that with the 9 eggs, the 2 ounces of peppermint oil actually makes 3 gallons.
Okay, so make it up to 3 gallons.
So that's just you're gonna mix it in the blender. You can't put 3 gallons in your blender, so just enough water to make a good emulsion. Yes.
When you say fall, what is your start and stop time?
Generally, we're planting bulbs beginning in October. We want the soil to be 60 degrees or cooler. So that'll be in October by the time it gets cool enough. If you plant them too early, they're going to start to grow too quickly, and you might lose some of the foliage. So
How late?
As long as you can still dig the hole, you can do it until December.
Oh.
So I wouldn't wait much longer than that. Okay? Who wants to go outside? So these are this is our spree garden. And these bulbs, this is an experiment. So come back next spring to see if this actually works. This is the bulbocodium, and one of the things about bulbocodium is it likes to be dry, especially in the summer. And this garden is the driest place we have in the summer. So we're going to try these bulbs here and see how they do. It's a very low grower. It's a good naturalizer. It just maybe gets 3 inches tall, but I think it should show up pretty well here. It's pink. It's like the color of Alice's Jack there. So we're going to plant these. Easy peasy. Just kind of scatter.
You need a kneeling pad.
Do what?
You need a kneeling pad.
Well, it's not bad. My cauliflower knee's not acting up today, so it's okay. So once the ground is done, it's really not a big deal to plant them. So
just gets her little planting nightmare.
Yep. And I'm just going to basically place them. I'm not very good at random planting. I really want them to be organized, but that's just me. Looks like I'm missing one. I must have left one inside. So now we're just going to dig down. Now how big is this? So maybe about an inch. So we're going to plant this 3 inches deep. So just going to move the soil aside. Very easy. This soil has a lot of gravel in it. So I'm going to point it.
Mine was like this.
And we're just going to plant it. It's 3 inches to the bottom of the bulb.
Oh, easy peasy.
So that's it. That's all there is to it.
Chris, where did you get the knife? I've never seen that.
It's Fisker's. Actually, I think you can get it at Home Depot.
Really?
and I forgot where I got it.
You probably got it from at the Master Gardener party.
I could have.
You could have. Bulbacodium.
Boy, I wish my soil was that nice.
Well, this soil was created today. I started digging it last night, and then the Master Gardener stirred it all up, and...
Boy, it's nice. Now, will you cover that with pebbles?
Yes.
And it'll come right up through.
Yeah, so now this soil is a mix of pea gravel, topsoil, and compost, which this whole bed was dug out, and all of it mixed with this pea gravel, and then we use the pea gravel for mulch. So we'll just mulch over the top, and that's really, at this point, because there's so much pea gravel here, it's really just for appearance.
Well, where do you get pea gravel?
Where did this come from? I think it came from Mevin Shrubbery Market. Makes a nice garden. It requires some weeding. So I'm going to go ahead and plant these so they're sitting out here in the sun.
Are you familiar with the compost that you can get from Burlington?
From the wastewater? From the wastewater or the leaf compost? The recommendation is that you not use it for vegetable gardens and that you wear gloves when you handle it, but it should be fine for everything else. It's fine. It's tested periodically.
Do they give it away or do you
have to buy it? You do have to buy it, yeah. But they actually said it's okay for vegetables.
Oh, really? Okay.
What they said. No, I'm not. I don't know.
Okay, well, if we're talking about the same thing, if it's from the wastewater treatment plant, well, maybe.
I don't know if they do something to it.
I guess it depends what the latest test is. You have to be careful when you use manure as an addition. It depends. If you use manure from a local farm, you have to make sure that the pasture has not been treated with Grazon or some other herbicide, which actually persists through the gut of the animal and can kill your vegetable plants in your garden. So we have some cases of people's tomato plants just up and dying because they've had a persistent herbicide that traveled through an animal before it came to their garden. Now, you don't have to worry about a bag of black cow having that in it, but just ask the farmer, if you're getting it from a farm, ask if he treats his pastures with Grazon is the one that comes to mind, but there are several persistent herbicides.
What are these bulbs that you're planting?
This is Bulbacodium, which I can't remember the common name right now. Something, Spring Meadow, something. Spring Meadow Crocus. Saffron? Something like that. Can't remember.
Yeah.
Alright. Now again, these patches, I put a little bit of lime, and I probably put a cup of lime in each of these two patches, and then I put maybe 2 tablespoons of superphosphate on each of these patches, which was then stirred in. So,
Spring Meadow Saffron.
There you go, Spring Meadow Saffron. Thank you, Scott. Fact checker. All right, that's it.
All right.
So, now I've got some more to plant, and I was going to show you a layered planting over here.
This is not.
Just don't want it in there. It's a lurker. Well, come on. Okay. Now with these, we're going to try and get them 6 inches deep. Now, I don't think any of you were measuring the other ones. So, well, if you continue to not measure, we'll be good. When the soil is loose, it's hard to keep a hole open 6 inches down. There we go. Okay.
You're fine.
Now I see you don't really tamp them down. You just kind of leave it loose.
Oh yeah, you don't need to tamp it down.
I'm going to put down 1,000.
You want it to be covered. And you don't want it deep enough because I'm going to plant another layer on top of this.
Oh, wow.
Of the same thing or something?
Nope, something else. There's a little one.
You can get double, triple.
So these are narcissus?
Oh, this is narcissus. This is the miniature mix. So I really don't know what it's going to be, but hopefully they won't be really tall. Because we really don't have a lot of stuff going on here in winter or early spring.
Yeah, yeah, it'd be nice.
There's another grub.
Very nice. Two grubs.
Another what?
Two grubs.
Yeah. Grubs. You don't like grubs much. Don't look if you don't. If you're a big grub fiend. Okay, fixed. We have so many Japanese beetles, green June bugs that I'm not really.
Yeah. You can see those big slugs.
Yeah, they are big.
Eden brother. Brothers. No, Eden Brothers in Nashville.
I think some of the pictures that I used today came from Eden Brothers.
Eden Brothers in Nashville. Yeah, they're nice.
Again, I'm planting with the pointy side up, easy to tell on narcissus. Pointy side up. That's the growth side.
Perfect.
And if you encounter grubs, make sure to spear them and bury them as a warning to their brethren.
That's right.
This too will happen.
I call it a scare grub.
A scare grub. Here we go. I like it. Should I put it on a pike?
You know, dress it in a little pair of overalls. Yeah.
This is almost beyond my reach.
You're not gonna be able to take care of Mother Nature. She's gonna take care of you. If you're gonna find Mother Nature, she's gonna bite you.
Yeah, and she's getting pretty
serious. Nature wins.
Nature will always win. So just be a little bit. Honestly, you don't
leave that one. It went all the way in.
You have a beautiful face. Go with it. Go with it. During World War II, they ate those bulbs for food.
They didn't eat the narcissus.
No, but they ate daffodils and they ate tulips.
Who did?
The Dutch.
Oh, the tulips, I bet they did.
They had no food.
I bet they ate the tulips. You can eat tulip flowers. I don't know about the bulbs.
Yeah.
But you can eat tulip flowers.
Yeah. I have very yeah, we got that last year. There's always good with it. Great with it. You're not a master gardener. You should come and just so you need to get the
stuff.
Yeah, get the stuff. Yeah.
Get the swag.
Oh, did I mention
you got to work for it?
Sorry.
Okay, so first layer is planted. Woohoo! pretty exciting.
Lovely. That's going to be so sweet when you come around the corner.
Yeah.
You come around the corner. This won't be up very far.
Okay, so the next layer is going to be the anemones.
Trish, what, she brought you something.
Oh, I can stay here all day now.
Mine is up. Your knees were hurting me.
All right.
Yeah.
Now, how do I decide how many we got here?
Okay.
We have the same color as the soil. How am I going to do this?
Are you going to put some of those on the other side?
Yeah, I'm going to try.
Okay.
Keeps your pants clean too, and well, nothing keeps your knees clean if you're in shorts or something.
Goodness, some of them are little.
Yeah, because you
want me to put your bag in there so you don't have to get up again?
Maybe I should have worn my glasses. This looks like rabbit color.
There's several right in there.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. Put flour on them before you put them down.
I should have. That's a good idea.
Did you take a before picture?
Of bare ground? Okay, these are going in 3 inches deep, and I'm putting them in sideways, remember?
Oh, yeah.
This is anemone, but you know what? I just decided these go about the same depth. And I'm going to end up digging them all up if I don't put half of these. This is the Iphion.
Awesome.
So
you're going to have a triple layer here.
Yeah, but the Iphion gets planted just a little bit shallower, and I'm afraid if I don't mix these in.
But some of y'all probably remember that we do have deer that come up in here.
Yes, we do. And we're probably thinking, why are they worried about deer? Look where they are. Yep. Look how much better it is when you can see them. Okay, so here we go. Sideways, 3 inches.
I try to avoid that at night.
I do too, because I can't see from where they're already
gone. I know.
She named them. It's not one of the anemone glands.
Grecian windflower, I know that, on the anemone.
What'd you say the little white one was, Chris?
It's Iphion. I can't remember.
Iphion.
Iphion. But I can't remember the common name.
Am I going to have to Google this again?
You might have to. It starts.
Iphion.
Iphion.
That's right.
Stay away. Move.
Iphthon.
No, Iphion.
Iphion. Iphion.
Yep.
It's M on the end.
No, I did not mean iPhone.
Star flower, spring flower.
Dark star.
Okay.
Iphion uniform.
Yep, that's it. That's
Cone.
It. Yep.
Iphion.
Iphion.
Eion.
No. Iphion.
Eion.
No e. Iphion.
Eion.
Oh yeah. Okay.
Spring star.
Yeah.
Is that it?
Yes. Okay. So, except it's blue. So.
Known by the common name spring star or spring star flower.
Okay. They aren't very creative ones. These are all named like that, aren't they? Aren't they all like the same name?
Well, apparently there's a lot of things in the Ifion.
Ifion, okay.
Genus.
Ifion, no. I can't say it then. Sideways. So you can see the hardest part is getting the soil prepared, and then just stick these babies in.
I would say probably the other thing is write down somewhere.
Only if you want to.
Yeah.
This is. Write down if you.
This is.
Write it down where you think you planted it. Take a little picture and say, windflower, star flower, miniature daffodil.
There's one right there.
Yeah. Let me get this first before I forget.
Because otherwise you'll dig again.
All right, here we go.
You know, like some idiot will come along and plant lilies.
Chris, you're doing a great job.
Thanks. I need encouragement.
You can do it.
Yeah. Scott's been my spotter.
We believe in you. I do. I mean, they don't. I was listening to you earlier. They were.
Hey, I gave them free stuff.
I know. That's the kind of thanks you get. They were like, nah, she can't do it. I was like, yeah, she can. And, nah.
I hope I'm not digging into it. All right.
I was like, you step back. You watch Chris do it. They're like, nah. She can't. I believed in you then.
Thank you.
Have you murdered any more grubs?
No, I have not. I have not seen any more. They must have got them all when they dug up the bed.
One over there.
Where?
Right.
Oh, the bulb. I thought you were talking about a grub.
Bulb. Sorry. Takes care of that.
All right. So I think.
Good job.
Did I miss one?
So pretty. Mm-hmm. Come around the little corner. Yeah, that color. Okay. And then they're going to expect.
Oh, it is one. I thought it was bark. Okay. All right. Oh, here's one. These little suckers.
I think your idea of rolling them in flour first is not a terrible idea.
Yeah, that's not. And I think there's some flour in there. I'm seriously going to do that before I plant the other side. Okay, so that's it. Except for the mulching and the watering.
What kind of mulch do you put on top of this?
This. This is actually well-aged double ground hardwood. So I'm just going to mulch it. I'll probably wait till after I water it and then mulch it.
Just wait for the rain.
Is it going to rain?
Yep. About 2 inches in the next day or two.
One of the things I dug up was some really, really old landscape fabric that was here. So now the other thing I have to plant are these leucojum. And I don't think I can match where it is over there.
You know, we pulled them out of that out last year.
Leucojum? Did we?
We did.
So, and we can't plant right under the overhang, which is right here. So we'll probably move it. Probably have to get the big shovel because I don't think this has all been worked.
Okay.
I'll probably plant it there. L, maybe not.
Yeah.
L-E-U-C-O-J-U-M.
Type it into Google, it'll correct your spelling and say land and say.
I had to redeem myself for Ifion.
Well, one letter.
Okay. I'm gonna plant these later. And I don't know if I'm gonna separate them or not. I might just plant the whole clump, but it's pretty neat. Anybody not get a bulb? Wants a leucojum?
Oh, no, I got bulbs. I got bulbs.
I'll take it if nobody wants it.
Well, you're standing there.
Okay, thank you.
All right.
Why didn't you like it?
Why didn't I what?
He's like, he said, oh.
She did?
I do like it.
Oh, I only give away things that I love.
Okay.
Excuse me. But you have, there's dirt.
Well,
there's a shock.
There was some of that dirt was crawling.
Oh. Some of it was crawling.
Some of it was crawling.
Oh, no, I didn't see it crawl.
Thanks, Scott. My hairdresser will get it. Okay, that's it. That's all I got.
Yay!
Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.